Well, a very good afternoon to all of you. Mr. Peter Burley, thank you for the kind words. So, the session chairman, Mr. Peter Burley, Mr. Geoffrey Piat, Mr. Lowry, other dignitaries sitting amongst the audience, all the participants and delegates of this today's summit on Indo-US Nuclear Safety Summit. In fact, in this slot, I think all of you in your registration kit, you must have found a booklet on today's program. Dr. Jain, the chairman and managing director, should have been standing here and speaking here, but maybe because of some other engagements, he couldn't make it. So at the last minute, I have made an entry here. And so when they asked me, do I have a presentation to make? I mean, in terms of PowerPoint presentation, I said, no, in fact, I came unprepared. So anyway, I'll just share some thoughts. And to save time, I think I'll restrict myself to maybe 10 to 12 minutes. First of all, I would like to congratulate American Nuclear Society and also once again welcome them to India. And this I am doing on my individual behalf, on behalf of Government of India, Department of Atomic Energy, and also as Joint Secretary of the Indian Nuclear Society, so on behalf of the Indian Nuclear Society. I really appreciate the initiative taken by the American Nuclear Society for collaborating with its counterpart in India and under that initiative establishing, I think more than a year back, establishing the Indian chapter of American Nuclear Society. And it's now 1 year since an MOU was signed between American Nuclear Society and Indian Nuclear Society. I won't really claim that some great things have been achieved after having signed that MOU. But I think it would suffice to say that we have probably moved into a positive direction. And we look forward that in the years to come and in the times to come, there will be much closer collaborations between these two professional organizations, and they will facilitate the participation of American industry while making contributions to the growth of nuclear power in India, and maybe the otherwise also in a smaller way. Maybe India contributing to the growth of nuclear power in US. It is also, today we are assembled here also to celebrate the 3 years of the Indo-US Agreement for Civil Nuclear Cooperation. Once again, I am very happy to note that today the American Nuclear Society has taken another important initiative or decision, I would say, and I am told that they are felicitating Dr. Anil Karpotkar, presently the member of the Atomic Energy Commission and the former chairman of the Atomic Energy Commission. Of course, in a lighter way, I am amused, you know, when I hear this news, and I once again thank the American Nuclear Society for that, but I suddenly remember that when the negotiations for the Indo-US deal, as it was known in those days, the Indo-US deal, when the negotiations were on, I think very often Chairman Atomic Energy Commission or his representatives, they used to go to US. At other times, the US negotiators used to come here. And we used to, naturally, it is part of my duty, we used to follow the news in both the countries, that what is the news. And I used to browse the internet for news from USA. And I used to be quite amused, I think, those days, if you can recollect Dr. Karpotkar in the American media, was described as the 600 pound gorilla. I think they restricted to 600. I think the maximum weight they assigned to him was 600 pounds. And ultimately, and I think I also have a photograph, because I did receive some photographs from the office of the President of USA after the agreement had been signed. And one of the photos, in fact, I saw that, you know, there are a series of dignitaries, they are standing, and in one corner, Dr. Kakodkar is there. And President Bush has come out of his place in that row, and he is exchanging greetings with Dr. Kakodkar. So later on, I asked Dr. Kakodkar that what went on between you. So he said, no, very pointedly he asked me, are you happy? So that shows that they were quite concerned, they knew. And in fact, I would like to share, because some of the things officially, I mean, they are with me, when the negotiations used to go on, what was it India was insisting upon, because of which he was called a 600 pound gorilla. Now that, in fact, I would say the very basis of the Indo-US civil nuclear cooperation, the whole exercise was done, I would say, on three pillars. And those three pillars were, number one, and naturally, see, the major part of what are we looking out of that Indo-US civil nuclear commerce? Mainly, it is for a rapid growth of nuclear power installed capacity in India. Okay, that I think probably the time doesn't allow, and it is not the right forum. Otherwise, I could have shared with you that what is our problem. We have developed the whole technology. We claim that we have developed the entire fuel cycle. We are capable of designing reactors. We are capable of building the reactors. The industrial partners we have in India now, in fact, for last couple of decades, they are in a position to deliver whatever we want. So then what are we looking at? And I think everybody knows that what are we looking at is the modest resources of uranium which are available in India. We have a three-stage nuclear power program in place. But unfortunately, whatever advances we may make, but we can't jump stages in that three-stage program. We can go to the second stage in a big commercial manner only after we have a sufficiently large base in the first stage. And we can go to the third stage only if we have a base large enough in the fast reader reactors. So having established that, we might be having plenty of thorium. We might be on paper be able to convert all the thorium into uranium. But when it comes to practicality, you need a lot of plutonium to run all the fast reader reactors, which will be required to convert that thorium into uranium-233. And to acquire that much plutonium, you require a large base of the first stage uranium base. And we know we have limited stocks of uranium. So it is this aspect that we are looking forward. Either give us uranium under the Indo-Civil Nuclear Commerce, we will build our PHWRs and go ahead. Or otherwise, okay, bring your reactors. Put them up here, we will operate them. This, again, I recall about 40 years back, the situation was different. I must express my gratitude as an Indian citizen to United States of America and to GE particularly. At that time it was not GE Hitachi, the General Electric of USA, for enabling the first two nuclear power reactors in the country. At that time the game was totally different. We did not know how to make nuclear reactors. We wanted to learn how to operate nuclear reactors. And we wanted to establish some nuclear capacity, as often in our documents we write that to jumpstart our capacity. See, we had decided that we will go for PHWRs in the first stage. But to jumpstart that stage, to gain some experience, hands-down experience with nuclear technology, we went for the boiling water reactors, which is now industry. In fact, they are still operating, the Tarapur units 1 and 2, incidentally older than the Fukushima reactors. And they are doing well. But here I must mention the times at that time were different. I vividly recall one of the statements of Dr. Bhabha, which he had made. While convincing the Indian government about that we should take up nuclear research in India, he had told that in a few decades from now, when we will have a trained manpower in the field of nuclear technology in India, we will not have to look outside for experts in other countries. So that is the change which has occurred. When we went for Tarapur 1 and 2, we had to, in addition to the reactors, in addition to the uranium which was to fuel those reactors, we also had to look for the expertise, for the knowledge to operate those reactors in a safe manner. Today, probably, of course, when a particular type of reactor comes, we have to exchange notes. We have to understand the design of that new kind of reactor, whatever is being put up. Understand that particular type of reactor. So that is the change in the situation from that 40 years back. Now, coming back to the present times, I was talking about the three pillars. So the first pillar is that whatever reactor comes in India from any country under international civil nuclear commerce, the first condition will have to be a guarantee for lifetime fuel supply. Because let me say, having thanked for Tarapur 1 and 2, I would also like to say that we were caught in a situation in the 70s, when we had the reactor running, there was all the investment done. The reactor had already run for so many years. And then we were suddenly told that no more fuel. So we would definitely not like to be caught in that kind of situation anymore. So that is the first pillar. The first piece of understanding when we are negotiating with any other country. And I think that was, I think if you look at the documents of Indo-US commerce, I think that has been made very, very clear. The second point was, again, it is, I think I can connect Tarapur to that. See, all these 40 years, the Tarapur spent fuel, we have been piling it up, we have been storing it in our pools. And it's really large volume now. And then we realized that probably at that time itself, we should have known what to do with this fuel. Now, when we look into the agreement signed 40 years back in terms of that, for the Tarapur reactor, we find that we are at a loss because this point was never made clear that what do we do with the spent fuel. Now, the situation is we can't send it back to the country of origin. And we can't reprocess it. We have the technology, but we are not allowed to reprocess it because that is not there in that agreement, the right to reprocess. So now, the second pillar of the Indo-US civil nuclear commerce and any other agreement with any other government on civil nuclear commerce, the second point has been the right to reprocess the imported fuel. Whatever fuel will come, and I think it was, if I understand correctly, it was on this issue that Akhotkar was called the 600-pound gorilla because he was insisting on that. And I think a lot of hours of negotiation were spent on this point. So that is the second aspect. And of course, third one is, I think for any country it will be true, that in no way this mutual cooperation should affect the independent, indigenous nuclear power program which is going on in India. So in fact, I mean, kind of a no interference in the Indian nuclear power program, which will use, I mean, assurance from our side was that we will use only indigenous technology. We will use only indigenous material in that. No foreign material, no foreign consultancy, no foreign help will be used in what we have declared as the India's indigenous nuclear power program. So I think on the basis of that, I would say we are doing well. I think last year there have been some discussions whether that second point, whether it will happen or not happen. Anyway, I am not an expert to comment on that. Now let us see that what is the scope of cooperation. Having spent already 3 years, what are the fields we are looking at? What can India gain? What can US gain probably? What can we both gain? What can the nuclear industry gain? And what can the Mother Earth gain out of all these cooperations? Naturally, I think let us talk about the gains of Mother Earth first and the foremost. Then we will talk about ourselves or yourself. What does Mother Earth stand to gain from mutual cooperation between a country like India and a country like US in the field of nuclear science and technology? Ladies and gentlemen, I think yesterday onwards, many times you heard, and you are already knowledgeable, you know that. I think it's a point of discussion in media, quite often it is discussed that Mother Earth is going through very difficult times. It is because of the increased levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. And in fact, people have predicted, I think if I could quote Professor James Lovelock, and there are many who have predicted if we allow the business as usual to go on, the end of life